It smells like my dog's tooth.
Restricted section,
and today we're gonna do a discussion of Beloved by Toni Morrison, and this will not be spoiler free. So if you would like a spoiler free video, we did a like brief review, which yes. We also posted, so you can check that video out.
Yeah, we'll link it down below.
Yes,
if you're interested,
if you want to see it.
And we're gonna drink some Guava King from Four Hands Brewing.
Yeah, this is just ale brewed with guava juice.
Yup.
So we're hoping it's not a sour.
Yeah, it doesn't say it is, so.
So we don't care for sours.
Oh, it smells not very good.
Oh.
It smells really gross. It smells
like fart.
It's bad. It
smells like Murphy fart.
It's bad. Let's do it. Does guava just smell bad?
I've never had guava. Is guava stinky?
I don't know. It doesn't taste bad.
No.
It doesn't taste great, though.
No.
It's really, the aftertaste is real weird. Yeah. Not a big fan.
Mm-mm.
It's alright.
It's okay.
It tastes better than it smells.
Yeah, but I mean, that's not hard to do. That stinks.
That smells bad.
Like, I don't want to...
It smells like shit.
Oof.
Like, literal shit.
If you were wondering what Murphy's tooth smelled like, it's that. That's what they smell like.
I feel like maybe it's just... Maybe that's just how guava is.
Maybe. I've never sniffed a guava.
I've never heard of me either.
So I don't know.
Alright.
Anyway.
So let's get into this discussion about Beloved, which is no laughing matter.
It is not, but now I feel like I have the church giggles.
Oh no.
Mm.
Oh no.
Okay. So this is a very dark and haunting book.
Yes. And it's about... a woman named Setha who escaped from slavery, and then she's living, at this point she's living on her own while her daughter lives with her. And then this girl named Beloved shows up.
Kind of out of nowhere.
Yeah, may or may not be the ghost of her dead daughter.
Yes.
Alright.
All right. So yeah, basically it's about her life now that she has escaped from slavery, but I think the question embedded in the novel is, has she? Like, right. Has she been able to escape all of the shit that...
Yes.
Like, the psychological shit that comes with having been a slave.
Yeah. And I think throughout the novel, it's clear that she has not escaped that.
Yeah.
Nor has...
Paul D,
who's a man who they were both slaves on the same farm, they have a romantic relationship later.
Right. Not while they're on the farm together, but later on. But yeah, so when Beloved shows up, I think we had talked a little bit before about how I think we both think that she represents different things to different people.
Yeah.
Because different characters have a somewhat different experience of her.
Right. Because Denver, who's Setha's daughter, living daughter, becomes sort of obsessed with Beloved.
Mm-hmm.
And just wants all her attention and all everything. Whereas Beloved is obsessed with Setha.
Right. And she only wants her attention and affection and... Yeah.
Yeah. And then for Paul D, Beloved is... malicious?
Yeah.
Toward him?
Yeah, but then she also wants him seductive.
Out and also seductive. Mm-hmm. Like, she doesn't want him in the house. She doesn't want him with Setha, clearly.
Mm-hmm.
She does seduce him, but it's almost like she rapes him.
Yeah.
Because he does say no.
Right. But he feels compelled. Like, it says, like, he feels like a drowning man, like, gasping for air or whatever. Yeah. It's obviously put more eloquently than that, but, like, he feels compelled, like he has to.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a weird...
Yeah.
Like, he's not super...
Like, he doesn't want to do right. it, but he can't stop himself.
Right. Which I think kind of goes back to the whole, like, them talking about how white people view black people in this novel as animals, or right. in that time period as animals. And I think that kind of alludes to... Because there was that whole thing about the Sweet Home men are men, and mm-hmm. they don't rape women, and they don't do this and that.
But they fuck cows. But they fuck cows instead.
Right.
Yeah, and that was mentioned very casually, like...
Like, it was no big.
Oh, we're not gonna rape women, but we need to release somehow, so we're gonna have sex with cows.
Right.
Yeah, and that...
I was like, you can't masturbate?
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I feel like that was, another way that they... Mm-hmm. showed, like,
they were reduced to animals, yeah.
And in a way, it's like, because they were treated that way, in some ways they then act that way themselves, you know what I mean?
Right.
Because, like, at one point in the book, Paul D says to Setha, "You got two legs, not four,"
mm-hmm.
after he finally finds out what happened with her children.
Mm-hmm. Like, you're not an animal, basically.
Yeah, because to him, she acted like an animal, because she,
mm-hmm.
you know, her slave master came to bring her back, because she mm-hmm. had escaped, and rather than have her and her children be taken back mm-hmm. into slavery, she attempts to kill all of her children. Kids. And I think probably would have killed herself as well.
I think so.
But... in a way that could be interpreted as, like, an animalistic thing to do, because sometimes animals do sacrifice, or if they're threatened, they're like, take my kid instead, you know, like, right. sacrifice their young to save themselves. And while to her, that wasn't what she was doing, you know, she did save herself by doing that.
She did. Yeah, they didn't want to take her back because right. she killed her kids.
Right.
So, yeah, but there are a lot of instances where the characters in the novel were likened to animals right. or reduced to animals by white people. And yes. I think, like, even if it's not true, if you're raised to believe something,
mm-hmm.
if you're treated by, you know, all of the people in power that you encounter treat you a certain way, I think that it's hard not to internalize that.
Yeah.
You know? And so all the people that they knew... who had power over them, kind of reduced them to that, you know?
Right. And there was that moment, too, more toward the end, where Denver goes to get a job
mm-hmm.
with these white people who were, you know, were known to be nice to black people and to, you know, actually pay them for
right.
labor and stuff, and so...
And to kind of help them, because they kind right, of helped so, with the Underground Railroad thing, too.
I think so.
Yeah.
So these were, like, nice black people, or, I mean, nice white people, mm-hmm. But when she's in there, she sees a statue of, like, a black boy kneeling, like, begging.
What with his mouth open, and there's coins and stuff stuffed in his mouth, and it says, like, yes'm, or, like, pleasure to serve.
Right.
Or, like, something really degrading.
Yeah, so it's like, even these nice white people mm-hmm. still don't view black people as equals to them.
Right.
And there was... really no, there was no white person who, you know, truly treated any black person in this book as an equal.
Mm-mm. No.
And, you know, I hear people are, you know, have the argument sometimes of like, well, you know, slavery was abolished 150 years ago.
Yeah.
You know, they should get over it. But it's like, you know, slavery was abolished...
But racism wasn't.
But then you had Jim Crow and segregation up until only like 60s. only 50 years ago. That's not that long ago.
Right. Well, that and like society has so internalized racism that like most people don't realize that they have like latent, like internalized racial, like racist tendencies. Like I was talking to someone who like is a, I mean, he seemed like a fairly tolerant person. He's educated. He has a master's degree. He was talking about someone he went to high school with, and he said, he's a black person, but he's really intelligent. He's a black guy, but he's really smart. And I was like, he didn't even think about it. Like, he didn't even, like, he just kept talking after that. And I was like, what?
Yeah.
And so, I like.
Yeah, and that, and I mean.
That's a perfect example of internalized racism.
Yeah. And I think around here, too, it's maybe more more prevalent than it might be other places because we live in southern Missouri.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, you see that a lot here. Mm-hmm. And even, like, much more blatant racism than that.
Oh, yeah.
Like, people throw, like, have white people throw around the N-word like it's nothing. And you're like, excuse me?
What now?
Like, we had someone we had, like, just met. Or you had just met. I had met him before.
I had never. That was my first time.
Yeah, Megan had just met him.
Yeah.
And he started, like, he was drunk, I think, but he starts throwing out the N-word. And, like,
we were like,
excuse me? And it's like,
what?
And it's like,
what?
I didn't get, also, like, why would you think that would be okay?
Because we're a group of white people.
Yeah.
It's like, it's four white people sitting around talking, and so he assumed it's gonna be cool. Like,
anyway, I feel like, I mean, that was related to the book, I guess, related. But it was slightly off topic. But yes, a big theme in the book is that, you know, black people were treated like animals. Mm-hmm. Also, there's the question of, was Beloved really her dead daughter, or was she, because there's also was an escaped slave girl, was she that girl?
Was she just a, like, was she just a figment? But that's not really, because multiple people experienced her.
Yeah, multiple people saw her, so I feel like she was real. But you never really know for certain, you know, who she was.
Right, it doesn't ever really.
Yeah. And this is the daughter, she killed, Setha killed her as a baby whenever this slave master showed up, and then buried her, and the only thing her grave marker said was Beloved.
Yeah, that was the only thing she could afford, and she had to trade her body for it.
Right. Yeah. And yeah, I don't really think that it matters whether Beloved was the ghost of her daughter or not, because regardless, she did still, like, represent that to Setha and to the other characters in the book.
Yeah.
But it's interesting to think about whether, like, Beloved was making, whether Beloved was making them feel that way, or whether they were, like, kind of projecting that.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right, if that's how,
they were just using her as an
right
outlet of some sort.
Or if the way that, I mean, their past kind of colored the way that they saw her.
Right.
You know, their experiences of her.
Yeah.
But one thing that I mentioned in our shorter video is, like, when Beloved's talking about where she was, like, when she died, where she was before she came back, it sounds like she's describing being in a slave ship. Like, based on what she says and her description of it, it sounds like she's in a slave ship. And so there's kind of, I looked up a couple of reviews of this book, and there's a few people who think that Beloved is, like, the personification of slavery itself, which is interesting.
Yeah. I could definitely see that, because she affects everyone a different way. But it's interesting how, like, I could never quite figure out her and Denver's relationship.
That was weird.
Because it's, like, it makes sense with her relationship with Setha and with Paul D.
Right.
But Denver was so obsessed with her.
Yeah.
Which maybe it's because Denver doesn't never experience slavery.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe she's obsessed with her because she doesn't understand her. I don't know.
I don't know. Yeah, that relationship was super strange, but Denver I thought was really strange.
Yeah. But she, I don't know, by the end of the book, you know, she stepped up and
she
and did what she needed to do. but I don't know. I marked a lot of places in the book, but I don't know if I could, at this point, I don't know if I could, like, find a specific quote. I marked a lot of places that I just thought were beautifully written.
Mm-hmm.
Like, here's a part that I really enjoyed where Paul, well, I mean, enjoyed in that I liked the writing. It's hard to say. This is one of those books where it's hard to say, like, I enjoyed this because it was so disturbing.
It was.
But this is a part where Paul D, he ends up being arrested and shackled and, like, forced to work like a mule, basically, because he tries to kill...
School teacher told him to kill someone, but he got caught, I think.
Yeah, he tried to kill a white man, I believe. But he's talking about how he can get through the work if he, like, doesn't think about it or whatever, but he feels this, like, trembling.
Yeah.
And the way it was described, I thought was just, like, so well... written. It says, still no one else knew it because it began inside, a flutter of a kind in the chest, then the shoulder blades. It felt like rippling, gentle at first and then wild, as though the further south they led him, the more his blood froze like an ice pond for 20 years, began thawing, breaking into pieces that once melted had no choice but to swirl and eddy. Sometimes it was in his leg, then again it moved to the base of his spine. By the time they unhitched him from the wagon and he saw nothing but dogs and two shacks and a world of sizzling grass, the roiling blood was shaking him to and fro, but no one could tell. The wrists he held out for the bracelets that evening were steady, as were the legs he stood on when chains were attached to the leg irons. But when they shoved him into the box and dropped the cage door down, his hands quit taking instruction. On their own, they traveled. Nothing could stop them or get their attention. They would not hold his penis to urinate or a spoon to scoop lumps of lima beans into his mouth. The miracle of their obedience came with the hammer at dawn.
Mm. Yeah. They sang, let's see. With a sledgehammer in his hands and high man's lead, the men got through. They sang it out and beat it up, garbling the words so they could not be understood, tricking the words so their syllables yielded up other meanings. They sang the women they knew, the children they had been, the animals they had tamed themselves or seen others tame. They sang of bosses and masters and misses, of mules and dogs and the shamelessness of life. They sang lovingly of graveyards and sisters long gone. And they beat the women for having known them and no more, no more. The children for having been them but never again. They killed the boss so often and so completely they had to bring him back to life to pulp him one more time. Singing love songs to Mr. Death, they smashed his head. More than the rest, they killed the flirt whom folks called life for leading them on. Making them think the next sunrise would be worth it, that another stroke of time would do it at last. I thought that was really, like, profound when he talked about that. Like, they were working and...
Yeah. I actually think, like, throughout the book, I feel like I marked more in Paul D's sections.
Really?
Than anyone else's.
Yeah.
Because I feel like he was of more... I mean, he was of more sound mind...
I think so.
Then Setha. Oh, here was something. They did kind of bring this up a lot where, here it says, for a used to be slave woman to love anything that much was dangerous, especially if it was her children she had settled on to love.
Mm-hmm.
And they mentioned that several times.
Mm-hmm.
How, you know, to love your own children is dangerous because, you know, in slavery, they could be sold out from under you.
Oh, yeah.
They probably would be.
Yeah.
Sold away from you and you never see them again.
Mm-hmm.
So he talks about how Setha loving Denver, her child, is dangerous. Mm-hmm. And
how her love is too thick.
Yeah.
Like, her deciding to kill her kids rather than allowing them to be put back in that situation
Yeah.
Her lip was too thick.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's, I mean, really appalling, the things that...
Yeah.
A lot of the things that happen in here. And, I mean, in some cases, they were treated worse than animals.
Yeah, I wouldn't treat my dogs the way that these, like, human beings were treated.
But even, I mean, because they're treated more like livestock.
Yeah, but still,
it's like even livestock sometimes gets treated better than,
yeah,
than this, you know.
Wouldn't treat an animal like that.
Yeah. And then, it did end on a really hopeful note.
It did.
Seth is in a really bad place.
Mm-hmm.
She's kind of gone off the deep end.
Yeah.
But Paul D kind of comes and says, you know,
mm-hmm.
we're going to get through this. Like, he's going to be with her.
Yeah.
And help her.
Help
her through this.
When I love, I think you marked it. I love what he says to her.
Because what does she say that she doesn't...
She always says beloved is her best thing.
She was my best thing.
She was my best thing.
And then Paul D says to her, you your best thing, Setha, you are.
Mm-hmm. And I love that. I love that part.
Yeah. Yeah, this book was just phenomenal, though.
It was so good.
I really loved it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was just so beautifully written, and I definitely want to pick up some more Toni Morrison. I feel like she's not really an author you can binge read because
your books...
I mean, if all of her books are like this, which from what I understand they are, pretty heavy, pretty intense, not something to be rushed through.
Right.
But, loved it.
Loved it.
Five stars. Yeah, 5 stars. I don't know what book of hers I want to read next. We buddy read this with Tina from Lectito in Spain, and I know she was interested in reading, because this is actually part of a trilogy. I don't think books... Yeah, I don't think that they follow the same characters or anything. In fact, I believe the second book is set, like, in maybe the 1920s or something.
Mm-hmm.
But there is 2 other books in this trilogy that I think they all stand alone as well, but, yeah, I think she was interested in reading
the others.
Those 2 as well. I do own, I think, 3 other Toni Morrison books already, so.
Yeah, I own a couple more as well. I think at least 2 more.
I thought about reading The Bluest Eye next. I believe that was her debut novel.
I think you're right. Yeah, I have that one and Tar Baby.
I have Song of Solomon and...
I read that one too.
Their Eyes Were Watching... No, that's not Toni Morrison. God Help the Child. God Help the Child.
But yeah, she's brilliant.
Yes. Love her.
Love her. So yeah, I think that's it for us.
Yeah, if you've read Beloved, let us know your thoughts.
Yeah.
And, should we revisit this beer, I guess? It's gotten better, I think, the more I drink it, but
same.
I still don't love it.
It still smells bad. Every time I bring it up to my lips,
It doesn't smell as bad to me anymore, either.
Ugh.
To me, it has lost its scent a little bit.
I just don't inhale when I drink it.
It's not great. I'll probably not drink this again.
No, probably not. And I really like Four Hands. Like, they usually have really good beers, but...
This one's
this is kind of a
swing
stinker.
And a miss for me. Yeah, but if you really like guava, maybe.
Maybe.
I don't know, maybe we're just not guava fans.
Maybe that's
I don't know
what
if I've
is.
Ever eaten guava before.
I don't think I've ever had guava in anything except for, like, shampoo.
Shampoo.
Yeah, don't eat that. So my herbal essences.
Herbal essence. Yeah, so that's it for us today.
There will be some links down below where you can find us elsewhere on social media.
If you haven't subscribed yet, please do.
And we will see you next time.
Bye.
Bye.